Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to year three of the TV Guidance Counselor podcast. I am Ken Reed, as always, your TV Guidance Counselor, here to talk to you about classic television that we watched, that we made, some of us starred in as well. And today is one of those starred in and made episodes. My guest today is Mr. Stuart Pankin. You will likely most likely recognize Stuart's voice as being Earl on Dinosaurs, but Stuart has been in a million things. You've undoubtedly, absolutely, I guarantee you've seen him in many, many, many things over the years. I specifically wanted to talk to Stuart because of all those many things that I enjoyed very much, but not necessarily the news being a big one. Dinosaurs, of course, a show that comes up on this show very, very often, and the movie Second Sight, which holds a special place in my heart. But he still works, does a ton of stuff, as I said, Night Court, so many things. You will Google him and you will go, oh, I absolutely know exactly who this person is. And he could not have been nicer. I want to thank him for allowing Rachel and myself to come into his lovely home and chat with us for a number of minutes that added up to hours. But great guy, fascinating guy, very smart, very talented. And as I said, has just been in so many great things with so many great people. It was great to get to talk to him. So I think you'll very much enjoy this episode. So please, I always say sit back, relax, and enjoy. But, you know, sit however you want. Be in whatever state of mind you would like, and I think you will enjoy this, although you don't have to, but I don't know why you'd be listening otherwise, but you will enjoy it. I know, in fact, that you will. So please enjoy this episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Stuart Pankin.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Stuart Pankin, how are you, sir?
I could be better, Ken. Thank you for letting me hold the microphone.
You're quite welcome. Most people, because of union rules, I don't let them hold their own mic because I'm going to get in trouble.
I've been holding my own microphone since I was a teenager.
Well, you do have an interesting technique, so I said this guy is well-versed in holding his
and
own microphone.
And seen.
I really wanted to speak to you because you've been in so many things that I've just really loved over the years.
Thank
you. And you're kind of the quintessential sitcom guest star as well. Like, it was always... Yeah, when I'd see you show up on something, I'm like, yes.
Well, I appreciate that. Show. Yeah, I guess I did over the years. I was in a lot of shows.
Yeah, yeah.
Happy to do it.
And you grew up in the Philadelphia area, right?
Grew up in Philadelphia, went to school there, moved to Massachusetts.
Oh, did you really? Where in Massachusetts were you?
Longmeadow.
Okay, so out in Western Mass?
Yeah, yeah. Briefly, because my dad got a job there, moved back to Philadelphia.
That's a big culture shock from Philadelphia to Longmeadow.
I loved it.
Yeah.
I loved it. Do you know anybody from Massachusetts?
Yes, I do. And I've met a few people.
Well, I love Longmeadow. And we were actually back years ago, but it hasn't changed that much. It's just an idyllic, beautiful place.
Yeah, it's a very 50s New England town.
Yeah.
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 And were you, when you were in Philadelphia, were you aware of any of the stuff that was like filming around that? Because I think like Ernie Kovacs' show was there,
no.
American Bandstand.
No, I was absolutely unaware of that. Ernie Kovacs, yes.
Yeah.
I used to watch Ernie Kovacs. But I didn't get involved in the theater or show business until college, which was way before you were born. But that was like in the mid-60s.
Yeah, yeah.
In the mid-60s. So, and by that time, we had moved to New York.
Okay.
So I went to college, lived in Philadelphia a little bit. My dad got another job. We moved to New York. And so for the Philadelphia stuff, American Bandstand, sure, I knew about that. I mean, I know of them, the Geeta with the Heater and all
right.
that stuff.
But they weren't like a local thing. Like everyone goes down and
not to me. Not to me. I guess I wasn't into that. I mean, you know. I was a Mel Torme man.
I see. Okay. Which makes sense because you were on Night Court later in a few episodes, and I think Mel Torme was in one of the episodes.
Well,
you
Mel Torme was a big friend of Harry Anderson. They were dear friends. And I met Mel through Harry because I loved him for years. And I actually played poker with him once. And it was a thrill just being in the same room with Mel Torme.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, and Harry, of course, was great, and Nyko was great, and he did. Mel Torme was one of Harry's idols.
Yeah, I mean, that the Night Court story generally about Harry, too, is crazy in that it seems like that role was written for him, but it actually wasn't. And
really? Well, you know that.
He had this, he saw a casting notice, and it was like, we need a child at heart magician comedian. Like, it was exactly him. And he went in and was like, this is me, this role? And then they were like, oh, okay.
And they cast him, but yeah. It wasn't written for him.
It was not written for him. That's what he says, but...
I believe it, because I have a friend who works much too much. And he was in 48 Hours.
Right.
He was in the bar, and he went into audition for something, and they were tepid, and he said, we're really looking for somebody like the bartender in 48 Hours. And my friend said, I was the bartender in 48 Hours, and he didn't get the part.
Yeah. Oh, I've heard stories like that all the time.
Oh, I get them myself. We need a Stuart Pankin type. I'm available.
Yeah. Not enough. You know, if you're very, yeah. I mean, there's Lewis Black, the comedian, has a great bit about they were developing a sitcom for him, and then he had to audition to play himself, and he didn't get it.
But you see, if your people, if this was television, you'd see my face not registering surprise.
Yeah, yeah.
Because it happens all the time.
Yeah.
It's just, and it, when I was starting out, there were a lot less actors, and it was a lot easier to get a job.
Right.
Now, 95% unemployment in Screen Actors Guild, and there are tons of very good actors out there. So it's, I guess I was lucky to come up and work when I did.
Right. So you're in college and you just started doing theater and then decided you wanted to do it?
Yes. I always enjoyed sort of performing in front of the family. But in college, I was a psychology major. I mean, I signed up to be a psychology major. But that first play notice came out and I walked across a dark, scary campus to get to the audition. And I knew in my heart that if I was willing to do this, that's what I want to do. And I never looked back.
Yeah.
And I had a teacher, Dave Brubaker, in college who was just so awe-inspiring that... I just kept going.
You had to go. I think the first thing I remember seeing you in, and I don't know if it's one of the first things you did, was probably Scavenger Hunt, I want to say.
Scavenger Hunt was, I think, in 79.
Okay.
Which is long after I graduated from college. But yeah, Scavenger Hunt.
With Vincent Price.
As my friends you say, it had the entire Hollywood Squares in it.
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at the cast list of Scavenger Hunt. It's hard to get it. I mean, I have a friend who they have Scavenger Hunt nights and they watch it, twice a year. But every person in Hollywood had a bit part or a large part in that movie. It was, and just to sit there and look at it, Tony Randall, Vincent Price.
Oh, it's crazy.
I never worked with Vincent Price, but, I don't know, Richard Master, Richard Benjamin, Cloris Leachman.
Richard Mulligan.
Yep. Scatman Crothers.
Yeah.
Robert Morley, Roddy McDowell.
Yes.
Jimmy Coco and Cleavon Little, who I kind of hung out with. It was great.
Was that the first thing you had worked on with sort of people that you watched sort of growing up or that you had watched in things?
Probably.
Yeah.
Yeah, probably. There were so many of them. You had to, I mean, I remember looking at all those guys that I mentioned and remembering Tony Randall and remembering seeing
everything.
Them.
That would be... almost too overwhelming to individually be shocked by them all because there's so many.
right.
Yeah, because it's like it's a mad world, but for the 70s, basically. And I love that movie. That was a perennial HBO movie. They just showed that nonstop on HBO.
Did they? I didn't get any residuals. Give me the name of somebody.
I'll get you the name. I'll get you the dates and times.
I bet you will.
That's what the TV guides are for. Actually, the joke I used to make was, so I have a bunch of TV guides in this kind of like spinning rack in the corner of our living room. And, if people were over, we'd flip through them and kind of chat. But someone asked me if they would go, why do you have all these? I'd go, alibis. Where was I on the night of June 5th? And I was watching this.
You can give a chapter and verse of where you were.
But I've yet to find a court case where someone has used that as an alibi. What were some of the shows that you remember watching growing up that were like your shows?
All right, let me think. Well, long time ago, I remember Winky Dink.
Okay.
Do you remember Winky Dink?
No, is this like a kid's cartoon?
It was a kid's cartoon, and what they did is they would give you, actually a friend of mine who I met later and still am very good friends with, helped create Winky Dink.
Oh, wow.
There was a cartoon guy, and he's on a mountain over here, and over here is a boat, is a plane that he has to get to, and they gave you a plastic.
Oh, that you draw.
And you drew a bridge across, You know, we said, please don't draw on your television sets, yes. kid. And you draw a bridge, and then Winky Dink would walk across the bridge and escape whatever danger he was in.
Which is hilarious because people think interactive television is like a new thing.
That's like, very no, interesting. That's
not at
that
all.
That was new. One of the first ones I knew.
Yeah.
I watched, there was a lady who actually, my father got her to mention my name, look through your magic mirror, and she said,
Romper Room.
Romper Room.
Yeah.
Yeah, and she looked through the mirror and says, happy birthday, Stuart Pankin.
You know, I see Stuart.
I see Stuart.
Yep, yeah.
I was on the Howdy Doody show.
Really?
Yeah, my folks brought me and my cousin to New York, and we actually stayed in a hotel, and I was in the peanut gallery. Big through.
Oh, I can imagine. I mean, that was and Pinky Lee were probably the biggest kids shows,
Pinky
right?
Pinky Lee, I used to watch Pinky Lee. And when I did Not Necessarily the News, Pinky Lee did a guest spot on our show.
Oh, wow. Not Necessarily the News is definitely a huge thing.
Well, that's a little later than
yeah.
that.
But Pinky Lee's sort of forgotten a little bit, I think. Pee Wee Herman was very influenced by Pinky Lee. He was sort of doing a Pinky Lee take.
Yes. My name is Pinky Lee. I know.
It was great. But for whatever reason, Howdy Doody was the one that everybody knew.
Well, yeah. I mean, I don't know why. I mean, as a kid, I just remember loving it. I remember the shock was walking into the studio, and it's hard to describe, but seeing Howdy hanging on a hook on the
what did he do?
And he was like literally hanging there, like he was dead. And then I said to myself, even then, they shouldn't do that.
And now on kids shows and stuff, they're very, very careful about that stuff. Right. Like even the Muppets, I remember someone told me they did something like a PA on the Muppet Show, and they were very careful about if there were children around, making sure that they never saw a non-animated version of the puppet, because when no one's in them, they really do look dead. Like there's no life in them.
Well, I did something called Free to Be You and Me. Marlo Thomas did it. And that was one of the, I guess the early Muppet, contribution. I remember Mel Brooks was a baby and he was a Muppet baby.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
And then, just speaking about me again, it's always
that's
about
why
me.
We're here.
And when I did Dinosaurs, that was the Henson Company.
Yeah,
that was Muppets, but it was extravagant Muppets.
Those are very mechanical. Were you on set for that ever, or did you do like a cartoon?
No, okay. It was a great set. I visited a lot, and when my school had fundraisers, we always, with the approval of the people, had the people sign up to bid on a fundraiser to go to the set of Dinosaur. Well, it was a great set. It was astounding because there was a platform and all the guys were underneath. Right. And then the guys who ran around in the suits were...
They're like athletes.
Well, they were athletes. And as a matter of fact, Bill Beretta, who was the guy inside the Earl suit, he actually, who is now, he's a huge producing element in the Muppets. He lost height being in that suit.
From like spine compression?
From the heaviness of that suit.
Yeah, because there's like a Buick's worth of motor in the head of that thing.
It was the most expensive television show at the time, maybe still, because of the animatronic puppets. Eyes. I mean, it was astounding. It's hard to describe, but you had these guys sitting behind and they put their fingers in controls and you could control the controls.
Yeah, like a mitt, right?
It's a mitt, and someday this could control this, and then if you wanted to change it, this could control, you know. It was astounding what those guys did.
And would they play, so that you would record your part first, and then they would puppet to it, or I wish. You'd have to loop, basically?
You'd have to loop. They did the show, and the first guy who did it was, I forget his name, Max somebody. He was a little English guy, and he talked like this.
Oh, really?
And of course, you know, Earl was not that.
Yeah.
So, after the show was done, I mean, really done, then they brought it in, and everybody who was in it, me and Sally Struthers and Jason Willinger and all those guys, Sam McMurray, we had to go in and loop to beeps.
Yeah.
You know what that is.
Yeah, yeah. That must be, because a lot of times in animation, they'll do the opposite, where they'll
always record
first, and then they'll draw it to the way that you do it.
And that's a great way for an actor.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the best job in show business.
Right,
be and I've done an awful lot of voiceovers in the past. That was Dinosaurs. I used to say Dinosaurs was a job I loved having and hated doing.
Yeah.
Because it was so exacting. Because you had to, you couldn't necessarily bring your own take on the scene or the dialogue. You had to go with what they said.
Right. Right. It's already been done for you. It's like dubbing a foreign movie.
Exactly.
Which is a whole different skill set.
But it's a great show. And people still like that show. It only lasted 3 years, but it was...
it was so memorable, and it was so subversive. The stuff they got away with on that show, it astounds me to this day. Like, I cannot believe the sort of humanist, sort of pro-environmental message they got through with that show.
Oh, yeah. And people fantastic. Still talk about the last episode, which I think I saw recently, when the world...
Everybody dies.
It was moving. I mean, people talk about that last time. And I agree with them. It's a very moving episode. Plus the other stuff, the environmental stuff. And
But it was important. Like, it made kids think about the world in a little bit bigger way, but wasn't really heavy-handed about it.
It wasn't heavy-handed. The adults could enjoy the double entendres, and the kids could enjoy the puppets going around saying, how you doing?
Yeah, which is what the best things are when they work on multiple levels like that. And it was essentially satire, but was also a sweet family sitcom without being cynical or snarky.
No, it wasn't. You're absolutely right. Which and I think if it wasn't so expensive to maintain those puppets.
Yeah.
It might have gone on for a little bit longer.
Yeah, I'm sure. I imagine the network probably looked at the per budget cost and was like, we've done three seasons. It's enough. Yeah. It wasn't enough to do syndication because it didn't make the Magic 100, right?
No, we only did about, I want to say 60.
Yeah, which is like almost the 65 sort of minimum cutoff. So it was hard to see for a lot of years because it didn't replay very often. And was, I think, the last thing Henson himself was involved with developing before he died.
I think you're right. And he died during the run of that, and then Brian took over.
Yeah, which still has, they've done all this stuff after, but that's the last thing that feels like Henson worked on it. Yeah. It has his kind of unique touch to it, which is the other reason that it sort of goes on and on. And I remember at the time, a lot of parents were angry about that final episode because they don't watch what their kids watch, and the kids tune in the dinosaur show, and then the kid starts crying and it's like, the baby died, everybody died. And the parents were writing, all these
really
letters.
That I didn't.
Yeah. And I remember, they didn't get to you. Thankfully.
No, they don't. I don't get any dinosaur hate mail.
Yes. But I don't know if it was the network or it might've been Brian Henson himself was like, they're dinosaurs. That's what happened to the dinosaurs. Like the Titanic thing.
But that's
what do you expect?
That's a little, I love that. But that's a little disingenuous because they're not dinosaurs to those kids. Yeah. They're characters.
Yeah. It's not a documentary about dinosaurs.
No, it isn't.
But is a a good answer to have. If we go back to some of the earlier stuff that you've done, and I also remember seeing you early on in a Barney Miller, probably as one of the earlier TV.
I did a couple of Barney Millers,
which is a show I love.
Yeah, it was great. It was great. Nothing much to say about it. It was just, what's his name?
Hal Linden.
The actors. Danny Arnold.
Yes.
Was considered a god on that set. Yeah. I mean, no matter what they did in rehearsal, when he came down to give notes, it was like, yes or no. I mean, it was amazing.
Well, and this may be apocryphal, so you may or may not be able to confirm this, but I had heard that after the first couple episodes, he managed to get rid of the audience, and it was one of the few three-camera sitcoms that shot with no live audience.
I never worked with an audience.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, rented a studio, so they had an entire studio, and they did the shows, at least one. And then the next time I came back, they rented a corner of the studio because they didn't need a studio.
It's one room set.
Literally it was stuck in a corner, which they probably took out every night when they didn't need it. And that's how the show evolved. But I don't remember ever working Barney Miller in front of an audience,
which was really unusual at the time for a three-camera sitcom. And I think what I had heard was they did a couple episodes like that, and he was just like, this is not working. I'm trying to write stuff for the audience, and we have a time crunch. And so he managed to go to the studio and say, I'm not doing it. And they were like, you have to have an audience. You can't. And then was the first and only person really allowed to film a three-camera sitcom with no audience.
Really? That's interesting. Which would make sense. Most of the other three-camera stuff or four-camera stuff I've done always had an audience.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was always a problem sometimes.
Yeah.
Because the audience is... Do you ever do warm-up?
No. Oh, that's a whole skill set.
But, these people come in and they sit literally for 5 hours, and they're supposed to, at the end of the 4.5 hours, laugh at the same jokes. Yeah. So they see three times.
Can we go home
Yeah,
now?
Can we go home?
Yeah. Because you basically have the whole... They cannot leave.
I guess not. Yeah. I guess elbowed your way out, I guess. Yeah.
But they're really like, okay, guys, come. It's almost like, I always think of it when I see, this is an odd parallel, but when they show footage in World War II in England when they're down in the subways at night sleeping during the raids, and there's people like singing songs. Yes. And like, we'll all get through this, everybody. Like, that's kind of like the warm-up guy is like, that's that right. Guy. It's going to be okay. We'll get through it together.
Yeah.
Did that lead to you working on Night Court directly? Because I know like Reinhold Weege worked on that show. Was that like just a...
No, I don't remember how I got that job. I think I auditioned for it. Although I got to meet Reinhold later through another friend who was good friends with Reinhold. I don't think that got me in. I think I went in, I auditioned for, in those days, most stuff.
You just had it going like anyone else.
I got here in 77 and, you know, working through the 80s, it's, people don't know you.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like, they don't know you. Oh, they know you. Now they don't know
you. They don't know you again. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it was, you're doing these guest spots, and then the first regular thing I remember seeing was probably not necessarily the news, which was probably, what, 82, 83?
Exactly.
Yeah, and that was Conan O'Brien's first job.
Yes. Yeah, I remember the joke that he wrote, which was still great, is a nun showed somebody the Shroud of Turin, and then she threw it in, I can't get this out, and they threw it in the dishwasher with the whatever product it was, and look, it came clean. That was his joke. He only lasted a season, didn't he?
Season, and then he left and went to SNL.
Whatever happened to him?
I've never heard of him since then. It's when you'd think he would have, because it's such an unusual name.
It is an unusual name.
Yeah, he got poached for, because when Lorne Michaels came back to SNL in 85, he poached some people from not necessarily news, which was kind of the only sketch show on that sort of in that dead time of 80 to 84.
I guess so. I know that Mitch Lawrence was on it, and his brother Matthew might have written for Saturday Night Live.
Yeah,
earlier
before that. Yeah,
before that, and then there were so many writers on Not Necessarily News, which is one of the reasons that it's not in syndication.
Oh, really? Because the
Writers Guild has a wonderful union that says if one person, you know, gets paid, everybody gets paid.
Right.
And if you and there were tons of writers, and they did tons of shows. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
I used to say to Moffat Lee, the producers, you make a dollar. What's the difference? Get it out there. People still talk about that show.
Oh, yeah. It was unusual how popular that show was, given that it was on HBO, which
yes.
a lot of people didn't have.
No. 29%, you should pardon this expression, penetration in those days.
Yeah.
And that's regular cable. That's not pay cable.
Yeah.
So HBO had less
smaller than
viewership
that.
Than that.
And so many people fondly remember that show with such a small percentage of people being able to see it.
It is. It's amazing.
I think it might even have been the first original show HBO produced. It was either First and Ten or that were around the same time.
That I don't know.
And it was a remake of Not the 9 O'Clock News.
Not the 9 O'Clock News, which they freely, give credit for.
So you just went in for a regular audition for that and got it, or?
I did. Well, a friend of mine, Ron Richards... I had done a show called No Soap Radio, which lasted about 5 episodes.
Okay.
Ron and Michael Jacobs produced that and created that show.
Was that a sitcom or more?
It was
like
a sitcom. It was a strange, hybrid, plot-driven, yet sketch comedy show, which is why they call it No Soap Radio, because it's the old joke. But Ron Richards produced it. Michael Jacobs, who later did Dinosaurs.
Right.
Produced it, so that's how I got to know him. And I met Michael Jacobs at an audition for the San Pedro Beach Bums, which is the first show I ever did. He didn't get it, but he remembered me, so when he was doing No Soap Radio, he called me in, and he gave me that job. Now, Ron Richards, who worked with him, I saw him someplace, and he said, I'm working on a show called Not Necessarily News. You want to audition? One of our guys left, Sam McMurray, who I'm still very good friends with.
Right, right, right.
I said, sure. Went in, I got the job. It was almost laughable in the early days. The first day we showed up, we were told to go to the Shell station on the corner. In the men's room was a makeup chair and the makeup lady. We were told that was where we dressed and made up. And we were told if you need gas, get it there because they're very nice. Girls
got a deal.
Girls were changing. They opened their car doors and were ducking down and changing, eating lunch. I actually said to myself after a day or two, I said, I'm too old for this.
Yeah.
And I wasn't that old. Then they finally gave us at least a trailer, a Winnebago, and we all shit. And then things got better.
But HBO
better.
Was, they didn't nothing. Produce things. They were like, we don't really have extra money to, we're
they
taking
know
it from, making interstitials to make a show, basically, or something.
Well, John Moffat started before, he did Fridays before Not the News. So John was established, and Moffat Lee produced that.
And you did Love at Stake with him as well, I think, right?
I did Love at Stake. Yeah. You've done your research.
I like television movies, yeah.
Love at Stake, that was another interesting thing. My son was 6 weeks old when we flew up to Canada to do that. Tough on my wife.
Oh, I bet. But it may have been the first movie I think Moffat directed.
It might have been the only movie Moffat directed. Yeah. I don't know.
It would make sense taking him from Fridays as the established sketch guy,
right,
to do that show. But you're not playing yourself. You're playing a character, which was odd for a sketch show. Like you had a character name.
You mean not the news?
The news, yeah.
Well, the big character was Bob Charles, who was the anchor man in the news thing.
Right.
But we all did. We all did anchor. You know, we all did news people.
Right.
And then the beauty thing about Not the News was you got to do so many different characters.
Right.
And I look at some of the old stuff. A lot of it is on YouTube. And it's not unusual for a man approaching the twilight of his life. I don't remember any, you know, filming half that stuff.
Right.
I mean, you look at this stuff and you say, did we do that? When did we? Right. We don't remember. But there was so much of it.
Oh, yeah. It was on for what, eight seasons?
It was on for 6 years. We did 6 years.
Yeah.
And then Chris Albrecht decided to revamp the show. I had left to do another series, short-lived series, called Nearly Departed with Eric Idle and Caroline McWilliams.
Ryan Lambert's brother was on that show. Lambert, the kid on the
show. Yeah, the kid, that's exactly it. You do like television.
I do, yeah.
So anyway, I gave my notice, luckily. Then the show became with two different people,
right.
Tom Parks and Annabelle Gurwitch.
Yep.
Tom Parks and I are really good buddies now. We play golf together. But that didn't last too long. That lasted about 2 years.
And it was slightly different. I mean, I think...
Very different.
Yeah. I think they still maybe had Sniglets. That was like the only thing
they
still had.
They might have had Sniglets. Yeah. I don't think they had a cast like of character people that did sketches.
Yeah. It was less like SCTV and more like what The Daily Show would be later, I think.
I guess
was kind of
I think
difference.
You're right.
That was the thing that resonated with me when I first started watching, because I'm a huge SCTV fan. And it definitely was more like SCTV than SNL. It had that...
Not the news?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It had that bizarre sort of world building and sort of...
What network was SCTV
on? It was produced in Canada first, and then NBC picked it up as Network 90 to replace SNL. That was their plan.
Wow.
It was Lorne Michaels left in 80, and they were like, we need something to replace this. They put it in the Friday night slot, and then they didn't want to do it.
I remember there was some function, and I want to say cable... But maybe not if it was that we were mingling with the SCTV people.
It would have been cable actually, because Cinemax, which was also owned by HBO,
right,
produced a season of SCTV channel Super Channel in Canada, and it was the last season they did. And that's when Martin Short and Andrea Martin and Eugene Levy were and Flaherty were the only people left from the original cast.
Well, and I remember seeing them.
Yeah,
I actually did a movie. Love at Stake was oh dear God! Tell
is
me,
that Catherine O'Hara?
No. Dave Thomas.
Dave Foley.
Dave Foley.
Dave Thomas.
Dave Thomas.
Dave Thomas. Yes. Yeah.
And I was actually offered a sitcom by Joe Flaherty and Anthony Newley. I think they made the pilot, and it was horrible.
Oh, that's,
and
I yeah,
and
that's
and
terrible.
You know, I just as a sidebar, I say to my wife, I regret everything I turned down now.
Right.
Because it would have just meant money in your pocket. Nobody remembers it.
Right.
But it was just a point in my life when it was just terrible. And it had Anthony Newley in it, who I love.
Yeah,
and, you know,
yeah.
And Joe Flaherty looked at me and he goes, when I said, I really don't want, he says, are you hot?
I said, do you have the ability to say no?
To say no to me? And I wasn't, but I just didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's my S... And I did a guest spot on Martin Short show. I guess I actually rubbed, you know, breathed the same air with a few of those people briefly.
Yeah. Did you ever watch SCTV, or were you watching a lot of stuff when you were working?
Yes, I watched SCTV. I don't remember a lot of it. I remember they were very clever.
Oh yeah.
And very smart. I remember Waiting for Chekhov.
Yes. Yeah.
You remember that?
Yes.
And it was like Anton Chekhov. They were very smart and clever and talented bunch of people. They were really good.
I mean, that's what I miss a lot. You know, on this show, we kind of focus on like pre-millennium because I think things changed a little once the internet came about. But all those shows, and especially sketch shows, and I think of like Mad Magazine and stuff, I learned about the previous 50 years of entertainment from those shows, because the people were sort of folding in stuff that they grew up with, you know, and SCTV is doing a Bowery Boys sketch in 1983.
Well,
you know, something that wasn't made since 50 years ago.
The rule of thumb, I don't know if that's the right phrase, but in the old days, there was vaudeville.
Right.
And then maybe burlesque, but vaudeville, that's where, you know. And from vaudeville came the early writers of radio.
Right.
And from the early writers of radio, and you're talking about quality stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Not nudie stuff, quality. Then from radio, then you get the early days of television. Now, the early days of television was, I mean, it's you know a lot, but that was good stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And including Playhouse 90 and the Kaiser Illumina, whatever they call those shows. I used to watch those, too.
So the dramas you gravitated towards?
I gravitated to dramas, and I don't know why, but in those days, it was Burles, you know, Milton Berle. I loved him. Jerry Lewis was kicking around once in a while. Dinah Shore. Maybe this is a little later. But those writers, you know, nowadays, it's my prejudice. Now they suck. The writers nowadays suck from stuff that has been sucked dry.
Yeah.
You know, and that's why you get so many.
It's derivative.
I can't watch a lot of television now, a lot of comedies.
I agree. I sometimes I'll just watch them for the, because like, especially where I'm at, people are like, you need to write a spec script for a show that's on or something. So I'll be like, I won't name the shows, but I've been asked to submit writing packets for some shows. And I was halfway through this writing packet and they put out a sketch and I was like, I can't. And it wasn't that I was just like,
that's bold.
I was like, if this is, but it was more like, I can't write that.
I can't do that kind of material.
And it wasn't like it's beneath me or something. It was like, if that's the kind of stuff you need, it's not what I can do. And I think I probably pissed off the guy, but I was like, I can't relate.
Well, here's my, because I don't know you real well, but you look real sharp and you probably could. You'd have to have a few drinks afterwards to get, get rid of the memory.
Off. Yeah.
But, you know, but it's like I say, I regret turning things down. You're too young to regret yet.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure.
But I understand looking at some of this stuff. It's, I can't watch it. And my wife, we just can't watch it. She'll say, I'm going to go read or turn it on. And I try to, in the old days when I was working fairly steadily, I try to watch everything, every new show that came along. I kind of still do.
Right. So you know what you could be in
for. I can't get through all of it.
Yeah.
I just can't get through all of those shows. I won't mention. And it goes even beyond that because it's not that I'm a prude, but I watched a recent roast.
Right. Oh, those are... Yeah.
What they were doing and saying on those shows were beyond tasteless.
Yeah.
And whoever sat around saying, this is funny, scares me.
Yeah.
It scared me. Because even years ago, I used to be in the movies and watch stuff that people in the audience were howling at. And I'm looking at it and saying, I'm a little scared as a comedian who comes from the theater mostly and has been associated with a lot of really good comedy stuff and drama. If that's what people want,
it's hateful.
It is. Well, that's interesting. I never thought about that. I know it's negative.
Yeah.
I know it's pandering.
Yeah, it certainly is. I always, two things. One, I'm a huge horror fan as well. And when comics will ask me about writing comedy, and I always recommend Stephen King's Dance Macabre book to them, which is his nonfiction book about horror fiction.
Wow.
And the reason is that horror and comedy mechanically identical, different payoff, but the setup is exactly the same.
That's,
it's just a slightly different payoff. And so the way I can illustrate to them the difference between those like horrible, hateful shock jokes and a good joke is, if you go see a movie and they throw the cat out and you jump, but then you kind of get mad at them for doing that to you, that's what one of those jokes is like. You'll get a reaction from the audience. It's cheap and it's easy, but then it's kind of at the expense of, you know, their relationship with you or just like your soul. And if you build a good character in a horror movie, you're worried for them. There's a suspense. And when something happens to them, it stays with you.
Of course.
Same with comedy, where when something funny happens to them, you're laughing with them because you know the character.
And sometimes in audiences, in the theater and mostly movies, people laugh because they think they have to.
Right.
Because they think they should.
Right.
And maybe they're not cool if they're with a bunch of people.
Yeah. Or they're
look at him taking his pants off. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I don't get it. Or they're used to, I think a lot of people, they get like the superficial, it's almost like someone who's learned English phonetically, where they're like, I know that it sounds like this, and at this, when I go up, it's a question. I don't know what it means. But so at the end, they're like, now I know this is when you laugh. I don't know why,
well,
but this is the stop.
You know, so I'm talking about Night Court, how Lyndon was talking about, there are other things, of course, but he's talking about two methods of comedy. There are rhythm jokes,
yep,
content jokes, and timing jokes. And I'm also adding like volume jokes. And yeah. if you can make obviously content and rhythm. And I remember one of my favorite things that said to me, oh, there's volume involved in comedies. When Nathan Lane and the producer said, there are two rules about being a producer. Number one, never put your own money in the show. Number two, never put your own money in the show. I'm on the floor.
Yeah.
And I'm saying, that's funny.
Yeah.
That's funny. It's not dirty. It's not cheap. That's funny.
Yeah, absolutely. And it'll be funny every time you see it.
Every time you see it.
It's not the shock. You don't know. It's the way it's done, not what is done.
What's your favorite horror movie?
Favorite horror movie of all time is probably, oh, geez, depends on the day. I'm going to go with, actually the original Dawn of the Dead.
Dawn of the Dead.
Yeah, 78, Romero.
I worked with a guy who was in that.
Oh, really?
Believe it or not.
Ken Foray?
John Amplas.
Oh, Gene Amplas, yes.
You know that name?
Yeah, he was in Martin, and he was in Creepshow, and he's from Pennsylvania.
He's been in Pennsylvania, because my wife and I were married in Pennsylvania, Latrobe, Pennsylvania, and John was part of the theater company for a season.
Okay. Yeah, that's all Romero
guys. It's a great movie.
John's amazing in Martin. He's the lead in that one.
Martin, okay.
It might be Romero's best movie. It's basically John plays this sort of troubled teen who either thinks he's a vampire or really is, but you never know. He's like it's chilling and interesting, and it's also about kind of the old world versus like this new industrial kind of crumbling Pittsburgh. It's really good. But the original one just resonated with me so much.
Dawn of the Dead?
Yeah, because they made a remake. This is a prime example of what we were just talking about. The remake is everyone running fast. It's a video game, and it's not scary. And the original one, I say to people, it doesn't matter that it's zombies. It could be killer bunny rabbits. It's scary because the reason they're dying is because they're not working together, and people are losing it for themselves, and that's what's terrifying.
See, my opinion about a lot of movies, horror movies, is the originals were great.
Yeah.
Like Nightmare on Elm Street, first one.
Yeah.
Great. Halloween, first one. Great. This is not maybe Tremors.
Yeah. Oh, Tremors is a great movie.
I love Tremors. Yeah. I could see Tremors every twice a year. I mean, it never gets tiresome.
It's so fun, and it's one of the few movies I've seen that manages to capture the fun of like the 50s monster movies without being silly.
And 50s monster movies too. Speaking about my past, I used to. One of the first things I did as a kid that made me feel big was I arranged with my friend Kenny. And my parents let us do it, go from suburban Philadelphia, take a bus, go down to see the killer mantis, or the killer...
Oh, yeah, yep. Mantis, the giant...
Giant mantis. Yeah, yeah. And we saw that, scared the hell out of me. It came from outer space.
Yes.
Scared the pants off. That's a great movie, came from outer space.
All those Corman 50s, monster movie, because... Part of it is too. I think this missed out on modern stuff is because now with technology they can pretty much do everything.
Yes,
they're less creative.
Yes.
So when they had no budget, they had to come up with interesting things and tell stories.
Let me tell you something. I think restrictions, like as far as showing violence or sex or anything in the old movies, led to a tremendous amount of creativity.
Yeah.
And you're right. They can do anything, and they do everything. And now people want more.
Yeah.
Oh, your head's torn off. Well, now I need it to be ripped in half first. Yeah. Oh, now I need your.
Now we're gonna put it back on, and then we're gonna take it off.
Then we'll take it off. Absolutely, I've believed that for years. The more structure you have, as far as limitations, the more creativity can often bloom from there.
Yeah, you have to get your message out in a way that is not the easy way. Or like, well, we can't do some spectacle. And so many movies now have become basically their amusement park rides and not movies.
That's
because
right.
We're not going to write dialogue between people and make this compelling because we don't have to.
That's right. Do it. One of the sexiest things I remember as a young man was I watched Spartacus, and Kirk Douglas and Gene Simmons, who is my all-time favorite, we're having a little love scene on a blanket or something after he just. It was, oh my goodness.
Yeah. There's a tension there.
But now it's like, Here it is, baby.
Yep, there you go. Yeah. It's like John Waters tells a story about growing up in Baltimore. There was some stripper that just used to already come out naked and be like, yeah, look at it. And that's how I feel like society kind of is now.
That's right.
Here it is. Yep. All right. Bye.
Well, like, don't you think, I'll be doing the interview now.
Fine. Please do.
Don't you think that the return to the creativity in movies somewhat are there because of the independent movies?
Yes, I think so. Because they have to be innovative because they don't have the resources.
They don't have the budgets. They don't. It's not CGI.
Right.
It's not, although my daughter-in-law works for a publicity firm that represents CGI. And I love CGI.
Yes, yeah.
But as far as stories and the independent movies that don't rely on the spectacle.
Right.
You can get some pretty good stuff. You can get some crap, too.
Oh, absolutely, because they're just trying to sell something. But, right. You know, I think that that's where we're kind of getting this golden age of television a little bit now, too, where people are like, you know, Breaking Bad and Walking Dead. And I've actually never watched these shows.
I have not either. Yeah. I started to watch Breaking Bad, and it was so violent in the beginning. Oh. We turned it off. Yeah. And yet, people that I know and respect say it's the best thing on television. And I kind of regret it, but I'm not going to do it.
Same with Mad Men. It was so many people were unlikable. It was unrelentingly grim. And I'm fine with dark stuff and grim things, but when you're watching something and you're just like, every possible terrible thing is going to happen to of these, it just, it wears you down.
But I got
to
tell you know The Wire?
Yeah.
My son and my daughter-in-law said, watch The Wire. She comes from Baltimore. She
right.
And I said, okay. So we watched the first episode. Again, violent, dirty, yeah. I mean, dark, not dirty, but dark.
Yeah.
They said, and they rarely say this to me, they said it about Arrested Development, which I didn't like in the beginning. My son said, please watch
Stick
it.
With it.
It was like, I couldn't get enough of that.
Oh, that show was
and the
great.
Same thing with The Wire.
Yeah.
I said, okay, I'll watch it again. We watched it. We got through. We knew it was going to be. And then it turned out, I think it's one of the best things ever produced for television.
That's one that I had the same thing. I watched the first one. I'm like, oh, I can't. But I'll have to go back because I, you know, it just.
Try it. Just stick with it. If you can stick with it. The writing, the characters, it was, look, I don't want bunny rabbits jumping through daisies, but I don't like, you know, that kind of violence. I got enough crap in my own life.
Yeah, you don't need to feel bad in your leisure time.
But, and the nice thing about The Wire is that the five seasons it was on, they're different stories. It's not, they change.
Right.
Some are better than others, but they're all worthwhile.
It's compelling. It's human drama.
It's very compelling.
Yeah, instead of just like events.
Yeah.
I mean, the other point I was going to make too about, I think a lot of those guys in the early days of TV is that they came from other worlds and were doing this for the first time. So they were ad men, or they wrote on radio, or they were vaudeville or burlesque people like, you know, Phil Silvers and Nat Hankin, who created that show. They came from different worlds.
The best, Phil Silvers.
Oh, I love Phil Silvers' show, and Car 54 is probably my all-time favorite sitcom.
I didn't watch Car 54, but Phil Silvers, I remember not necessarily the news, somebody said to me, we need to laugh. Say something funny. I said, Phil Silvers.
Yeah. Yeah.
They didn't, half of them didn't get it.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah.
They just didn't get it.
He was just everything. And that show's so modern. When you watch
Sid Caesar?
The show now. Sid Caesar, yep. I met him when I was 2 years old, which I didn't remember. My parents were, my dad was kind of cleaning out stuff, and he's like, I have your Sid Caesar autograph. I was like, what are you talking about? He goes, well, you don't remember that? I'm like, no. He goes, yeah, you were 2 years old, and you somehow found out he was doing theater and made us go meet him.
Good
and
for
so
you.
So he signed this thing, and I met Sid Caesar.
I got you beat, though. I played poker with him.
Oh, wow.
Twice.
Wow.
Played poker with Burl a couple times.
Did they win?
I don't remember. I was standing
Did you let them win? Yes, Mr. Caesar. What was the context of that? Like, you just got invited, or did you work with them?
There's a friend of mine who has what they call a celebrity poker game.
Okay.
It started out like 60, 70, 80 people. And in the old days, I sat across the table from those guys, Rod Steiger, Tony Curtis. I mean,
that's
Jerry
Vale,
Mel Torme was there.
Yeah.
And that's how I got involved. Yeah.
At least you didn't have to play Silvers, because he would have mopped the floor with everybody.
Phil Silvers.
Yeah, he was.
Was he good?
He was he was a major gambler.
I wish I'd lost a lot of money to him just to sit across the table.
There's a story from the set of Milton Berle's story from the set of Mad Men World, where they had no dailies on that movie because it was 70mm, and so it was a budget thing. They had no dailies.
Wow.
So they're in the makeup chairs, and Phil Silvers goes, I forget who he said it to. He goes, I bet you $20 I can make Milton Berle call his agent in 5 minutes. And they're like, all right, how are you going to do that? And he goes, I won't say anything to him. And they're like, sure, you're on. So Milton Berle sits down, and he's getting his makeup done, and Phil Silvers turns to this other person and goes, I think on the dailies yesterday, you could have done this better, and starts talking about the dailies that don't exist. So he sees Milton Berle get like steaming angry and go outside and be like, how come everybody's seeing these dailies except me? What's going on? And he's like, $20. Like he would do all that kind of stuff.
That's so funny.
So he was constantly gambling on the set of things. And like that character he played was, that was him as far as, you know, everything.
I loved him. I loved everything about him.
Yeah. Yeah. And he came, he had a whole life before he was an actor on television. I think that's the difference. These people had a whole life before.
You mean in show business?
In show business or just lived. I think now you get people who are like, I went to acting school when I was 9 and I've been acting ever since.
Well, that's what happens now.
Yeah.
And you don't even get kids in California. Forgive me for bad. My wife says, don't badmouth anybody. But I'm not naming
it's not badmouth. It's an observation.
Well, the observation is that young people, they get out of college or maybe not. If you're good looking, you know, you come, you audition, you meet an agent and you get in a show. Yeah. In show business.
Yeah.
Instead of, I mean, my prejudice is, like I said, I mean, I started in theater. I love theater. I'm doing a play, you know, now.
Right.
And I think that's great training. I think that there's something missing when kids don't do that. You just jump from college or even acting schools right into shows and movies and starring roles.
Yeah, you're a movie star now. You didn't build up.
That's just right.
Boom. Yeah. Or now, even three-camera sitcoms, which are like sort of a midway between theater. There's so many fewer of them now.
Yeah. And I'm not saying that there can't be terrific people coming out of acting schools or you know, getting off the bus from Nebraska. I mean, hell, Dee Wallace. I met Dee Wallace. We did a children's show together in New York. She was literally had the fumes of the bus on her
right
when we both started to do this children's show.
Yeah.
And Dee's, you know, she's great.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, she's so nice. She seems like someone you know. Like, she has that thing about her whenever she's in stuff.
And I run into her occasionally. And she, the nice thing is that, and she's, I think she's a very spiritual person.
Yeah.
So, and that's nice.
Yeah. Yeah. It's grounding for a lot of those people because you can get caught up in a lot of that sort of stuff. But they, you know, the like Eddie Albert's the guy I always think of. Eddie Albert was a World War II war hero. And so when he's on Green Acres and he's yelling at someone, he brings this gravity and like rage of a guy who's had decades of life, you know, behind it.
I love him. I think he's great.
Or Vincent Price, you know, he's writing cookbooks and curating art shows. You know, it's just like a whole, they're not just that thing. And I see so much less of that now. And it to me, it translates when you see people in things where they're less, you know, there's less depth or something. I don't know what it is.
I don't either. And you just know, and I don't want to analyze it too much, but you just know if you look at it and you react to it, great. If you don't react to it, you know, guess what? You can...
Yeah, you can watch the sum total of everything ever made we have access to right now, which is...
But in my day, I had to walk 20 paces across the rug to change channels. Now,
but that stuff sticks with you. I think that, you know, if you had to travel to go see Manta, you know, you're going to remember it more because you had to earn it.
I remember our first television choice. Said, should we get a remote control? I says, no, we don't need a remote control. We can get up. It'll give us good exercise.
Yeah, that's why we have kids.
3 weeks later, I said, get the remote
control. I can't do this the 5 feet away. But I think a lot of shows did well because people didn't want to get up.
Well, isn't that some of the theory behind having a good lead-in?
I mean,
people had a good lead-in. They didn't change the channel. Now, having a good lead-in, to me, means... nothing.
Yeah, it doesn't either, and the networks don't know what to do about
and
it.
And with VCRs, or VCRs, God.
DVR.
With DVRs, thank you. Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah. But actually, I you know, thinking about it, when you say VCR, that not necessarily the news was one of the first shows I remember people would tape and copy and give to people.
Really?
Because only, you know, few people had HBO, and that's kind of how it developed that sort of culty crowd, because it was like, you got to see this thing. I taped this.
That's cool.
So that might make a little more sense. Thinking about it now, why it seems to, more people
last
seem
a little
to have
bit.
Seen it than on paper.
I hope you're right. I mean, if people, you know, either send me requests for things or see me in the streets, it's usually dinosaurs and not necessarily the news.
Do you get recognized just for your voice? People are like, Earl?
Yeah. Rarely.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what did happen once. We were in a noisy restaurant and a guy came up to me from two tables away and he says, I'm a sound guy. You do Earl. I mean, he heard. I said, you're in the right business, pal.
Yeah. You got an ear.
But for the voice, no.
Yeah.
Not really.
I actually saw you in person once in Boston for Second Sight. You were filming Second Sight in Boston in 88 or 89. Bronson Pinchot and Joan Marquette.
78. It was probably 89 because my son was about 3 years old.
Yeah, and that was very exciting because they
for me too.
Yeah, they had never. Oh, meeting me is very exciting. But that, I mean, I love that movie, and that was, you know, Joan Marquette was one of those guys that, you know, you're a TV actor, or you're a movie actor. Very few people broke through. It was like Tom Hanks, Robin Williams.
Robin Williams is a biggie.
And Bruce Willis. They were like the big people who are on TV.
You're right.
And Joan Marquette, that was like, that guy's, you know, a movie star, and that lead.
He's a good actor,
work.
But he didn't do a lot of them. I think he did very few movies. Did a lot of television stuff different from his character.
And I loved that. I was so excited they were filming that movie. And it's a funny movie.
It's a funny movie. Yeah. It's a problematic movie.
Okay.
Because it happened during the writer's strike.
Oh, right.
Now, who wrote Dead Poets Society?
It was...
I want to say Tom Holland, but I don't think so.
Tom Holland, yeah, I can't...
Anyway, he wrote the original script for Second Sight. It was a great script.
Yeah.
It was during the writer's strike.
Right.
Certain people didn't like the script.
Okay.
And every night, they'd go home and rewrite the script.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. Not mentioning any names.
No.
And the movie was, if they'd done the original script, it would have been, it would have been fine. Better. You know?
What was better about it? Was it like darker or just funnier?
It was just a little funny. It made more sense. Right. I mean, if you might not remember, but they had to do an edit at the end when they're in, and I don't remember. It's been a long time.
Oh, I probably
But they're
remember
in
this.
A cartoon world where a frog is taught. I mean, that's how it ended up.
Yeah.
So it was a problematic because of that, because of the writer's strike.
Right.
And it wasn't the original script, which I believe was better.
Yeah.
That's.
I mean, it's sort of a lost movie around Boston. In Boston, we have these tours of like where they shot movies, and it's always like, here's the movie where the gangster killed a man, and the other movie where a gangster killed a man, because that's all. But I'm like, we had all these comedies for a while. There was Celtic Pride was right after Second Sight, but Second Sight was a huge deal, and like we would go and watch Behind the Barriers, filming the scenes.
Oh, it was 10 weeks of filming in that town.
Yeah.
I loved it. I mean, it was my first... I guess major role in a
big movie.
What was it? I did Fatal Attraction in 86.
Right.
Or 85, and it was released in 86 or 87. Fatal Attraction, I mean, Second Sight was after that, and it was because Bernie Brillstein, who was my manager, became president of Lorimar.
Right.
So he put Bronson and Larroquette.
Bess Armstrong.
And Bess Armstrong.
Yep.
And John Shuck and... I'm not good with names.
It was a lot of TV.
And me. Yeah. You know, and the thing is, I was the third guy, but I did a good job.
Oh, yeah.
And the studio kept calling Bernie. He says, you know what, he's doing a good job. However, on the poster, the poster said Second Sight, and coming out of a Mano cover in Boston, which we had to get permission to go into.
Because, you actually went in.
Because it was in one of those cobblestone historic streets.
Yeah.
But on the poster, Second Sight, Bronson Pinchot rising up, John Larroquette rising up, and over here floating, a dog.
Yeah.
There were three of us
in the movie.
I'm in the movie.
Yeah, and you're a major role. Like, you're the ground. You have a lot of the funny lines and a lot of the it's not even straight man stuff. It's like the grounding stuff.
You need this character. You needed that character to make those two crazy guys.
Yeah, but you get cast as like a doctor quite a few times, or like an authority kind of guy.
Yeah, I guess so. I should have my resume. I don't remember.
No, it's fine. I know.
I've been a doctor on Night Court. On Night Court.
Yep. And a few other. I just have a weird memory of like Stuart's usually like a doctor or like a guy that comes in as like an authoritarian. Like, I'll fix this kind of thing. Like,
yeah, doctors.
An expert.
So I have played doctors and lawyers a bunch of times.
Do you have a favorite role that you feel like is the most you, or like is
the most me?
Yeah.
Well, just because it became such an iconic thing, the Fatal Attraction experience was really good. I've enjoyed doing. I don't think there's a project I have not enjoyed doing.
Right, right.
I mean, lots of people wait. You know, some theater stuff years ago. I couldn't wait to get home. But no, yeah. I mean, no, they've all.
It sounds like you rewatch your own stuff and don't have a problem with it, or.
You know, I don't usually do that. Well, occasionally when I'm trying to put together a reel,
right,
I'll put together some stuff. Some of my favorite stuff is actually for benefits that I've done for friends, schools, and, right. and that I've done, and I on very badly photographed VHS right. tape. But those are the most fun.
Like emceeing stuff, or
no, you can't see it. You'll never see it.
No, like emceeing a charity event.
No, these were. I write lyrics, okay. parody lyrics. Yeah. So what we do is my friend Paul Kreppel, who's also
He was in It's a Living.
He's in It's a Living. But I've known Paul for 30 years. But we got together and we play song and dance people, but we do song parodies
right.
of Do You Love Me and Everything's Beautiful, the ballet, and we've done about three of that. Those I love.
Right, very vaudeville.
You know, it is very vaudeville. Yeah. It's very vaudeville.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why I liked it.
It makes sense. I mean, if that's the kind of thing that you're gravitating to.
But there's things, it's interesting, there are things that I'm proud of. And but you ask the question, it's most you. I that's a good question because I don't know. I mean, right. I can't point to anything that says it's me, because there's always something in an actor's mind, even when you get a part that's kind of close to you, and then right. you're supposed to always have something in you that's. But there's always that little part that clicks into something else, so that right. you don't want to be yourself,
right?
Because maybe it makes you a little too vulnerable.
Yeah.
But it's a great question, and I, when you leave, I will think about it.
Well, feel free to let me know later. I can let people in on the end.
Well, it's a good question. I mean, you can say what's your favorite things, and I can mention any number of favorite things that I've enjoyed doing, but that's closest to me.
Yeah, it's interesting. With everyone who's an actor either has the same trouble you do, where they have difficulty, I think, thinking of one, or they're like, well, everything I do is basically just me. You know, it's kind of like, which, but not everyone is kind of, or somewhere on that spectrum, you know?
Yeah. Olivia said the actors only have 5 people in them.
Right.
That's what he said. There's only 5 people in them.
It's a pretty good number.
That's a lot
of people.
And a lot, and the thing is that I'm not even talking about people who go long times on series. Even when you see them in other things, they're always often the same. Yeah. And it's, in my opinion, it's what made movie stars. Yeah. Like Jimmy Stewart is for the most part the same, Spencer Tracy, Cary Grant. But it's what they're selling, you love watching.
Right.
And they don't necessarily come up with accents or funny walks or funny. But that's, and the thing about even stars or actors today, when they go from show to show, sometimes they're very much the same.
Yeah.
But if you like them, you watch it.
Yeah.
I don't remember names, but there are certain actors that I think about. If I see them, I said, oh, I'm going to watch that.
Yeah.
I know what I'm getting.
Yeah.
But I enjoy what they're giving me.
Which is the comfort part, I think. You know they're not going to steer you wrong, and they're not going to violate sort of the trust you have with them.
And I'll tell you another interesting thing. Well, it's interesting to me, maybe not to you.
I'm sure it is.
Sometimes if you're too much of a character person, in other words, if you can do any number of things, mm-hmm. and I pride myself in saying I can do a number of things because I do a lot in the theater over the last 50 years. That's not what they want in California.
Right.
They want you to come in, you know, I've often said as a joke, I said I should have come in 77 and gone, hey, how you doing? Stu Pankin, I'm from New York.
Yeah.
You know, and just done that. And then when they need a New York guy, they cast a New York guy. My friend Bobby Costanzo, he works all the time.
Yeah.
And that's, you know, he's great.
That's what
he does.
Yeah.
But if you can do other things, they don't want, you know.
They can't imagine.
No. I mean, I could go in and go, hey, how you doing, blah, blah, blah. And then Bobby comes in and does it, you know, because it's in his soul.
Yeah.
He gets the part.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's a hindrance to a character actor in California. Not necessarily on the stage.
Right.
And not necessarily if you're doing a repertory company or a resident company.
They want sort of specialists.
They can have what they want.
Right.
There's too many actors. If they want a 6'3" Southern gay guy with a scar, they're going to find him.
Right. They'll probably have 3 to choose from.
They're going
to
find him.
Yeah.
You know, they don't have to, you know, and you can come in and try to be that.
Right.
But in casting nowadays, there's just so many good actors and not so good actors, but sometimes good actors get the part and sometimes not so good actors get the part.
Right, right. Because your fate's not in your hands at that
point. It's not in your hands anymore.
And it's unlike other businesses. And I found this in stand-up in Boston as well. You know, when people don't necessarily retire. So when more people come into the business, it just means there's more people. It doesn't mean there's any more jobs.
There's
just more and more people. So now you're just competing for the same things, and it's just exponentially getting bigger.
You're talking about live venues.
Live venues are even just parts and things. So it's like, you know, there's, you know, an actor who is in playing that similar role. There's a new actor who does a very similar role too, but there's only one of those roles. And now there's three guys who kind of do that. And then there's four guys. The top end, they're still there.
See, that's very interesting, because when we were at Columbia, one of our great teachers said, maybe the thing that you guys should do is don't go to Los Angeles, don't stay in New York. You go to Chicago, go to Boston, go to Arizona, go to Philadelphia, go to some places where you can get jobs in companies without the competition.
Right.
However, and that was great ideas back in the day, and I didn't do it. I stayed in New York, and then I went right to California. I was like, good at the kind of series, and I would never have just come out to California and try to get work.
Yeah.
Not looking to where I look. I mean, if I was 6'3" and gay with a scar,
you'd have your pick of roles.
I'd have that pick of roles. But the other problem is, and it is a problem as far as quality, and it shouldn't be a problem as far as actors getting work. There are so many outlets in television.
Yeah.
So many stations, and now cable and web stuff. And you'd think that actors could be working more often, and they don't.
No, it's. I think part of it is the people who make money off these things don't quite know how to make money off a lot of those things yet. So there's not as much. It's changing a little bit, like Amazon and Netflix and stuff are in this sort of arms race, where they're just like, green light everything and we want to win. We're going to have all the content. So you're getting some interesting stuff, which is kind of what we had in the early days of cable, but the bubble will burst at some point.
Well, you can't have quality, if that's what people are looking for, with so many outlets for product.
Yeah.
I mean, they demand so much product.
I think there's also fewer, not that it's an auteur kind of thing, but like a guy like Danny, who did Barney Miller, there's fewer people who are like, this is my thing and I'm going all the way through with it, which tends to be difficult people, but they tend to make memorable, interesting things because it's so them.
Right.
Whereas now so many people are like, whatever you want, I just want to make my thing. If you want me to change it, that's fine. Just please let me do it.
I agree. I mean, the whole thing that I grew up with is you write what you love.
Yeah.
You know, and like when I was directing plays, my director mentor said, when you're having trouble, remember why you picked this play.
Right.
What do you love about this play? And then go for that. Now, it's like we said, you know, somebody looks at Two Broke Girls and says, oh, I can do that. And then they write a Two and a Half Broke Girls, and it goes on and on and on, and it gets diluted. I mean, it just gets watered down.
Yeah, well, people want those little snippets. They don't care about the thing I always complain about is that people are missing context and intent now. It's very much the superficial, this is the exact, it's almost like reading a legal document. It's like, here's what you said, but they don't put it in a context, and they don't want the intent or where the, which may, ruins character. It's you can't have that without that.
Right.
It's very, very frustrating, but I think it'll come back around. It has to.
Well, the problem also is it's so many, they throw around phrases like brilliant.
Yeah.
Genius. Oh, genius.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
I mean, again, no names, but we were watching a screening of something and somebody's watching, somebody says, oh, she's brilliant. Woman is brilliant. She's going to be a star. Well, I'm looking at Joy saying, this woman should go back to school.
Does he know what brilliant means?
You know, I mean, but they throw it around.
Yeah. So they don't have to work as hard to get good at a thing. Almost.
And then people believe that. Because if you're somebody that writes about stuff.
Yeah.
Or does reviews that public read, and you keep reading, oh, it's brilliant. People say,
says it's brilliant.
They said it must be brilliant.
Must be.
And if you don't like it, it's your fault.
Yeah.
Like, it's like my director in the theater that Joy and I worked at and for years. He says, if the play's bad, the audience will think it's them.
Yeah.
Because it can't be bad because they're professional actors putting it on.
It's a play.
And they'll say, well, we're just not into this theater business, and they'll stop coming.
Yeah.
So the responsibility of at least in the theater, which is I always go back to, is you got to be good. You got to be good so the people will like it and come back.
Yeah.
Because they'll blame themselves.
Yeah. Yeah. I think the same thing.
Really?
You know, it's so many people do like a self-indulgent stand-up act, and then if people see it, they go, I guess I hate stand-up. And it's like, no, you hate that stand-up. He's not good at it.
That's right.
What you hate. But they, I always joke that it's like stand-up sort of a genre and not, it's a medium, not a genre. But so people see it once and they go, I hate it. But they don't just show up at a multiplex, go in a random theater, and then end up, seeing a Saw movie and go, I hate movie. You know, this is not what I think of when I think of movies. I did not expect this, and it's weird how they.
And I'm proud to say I've never seen a Saw movie.
You're very lucky. It's that's for horror. That's where I say horror has gone from being about sort of psychological angst to physical pain.
Oh, it's horrible.
Instead of being like, oh, I hope nothing bad happens, it's ooh, that I bet that hurts, and it's a very different way to watch.
The older I get, the less I want to be assaulted.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I want some endorphins. I don't want to see people sawing their legs off or their arms off. Or,
is there anything you watch now as like a comfort show? Do you ever revisit things that are like you're going to relax?
Probably watch too much. not necessarily. Okay, I'll tell you what I watch if I can remember. It's been so long. The season, there's been no new shows.
I know.
And it breaks my heart.
It really does.
I like, for better or for worse, and don't judge me, America.
I won't.
Love Last Man, like Last Man Standing.
Okay, that's Tim
Allen.
Allen, yep.
Like The Grinder, I think that's very funny.
Oh yeah, Rob Lowe and
recently we've been watching a show called Brain Dead.
Okay,
Brain Dead is great.
Okay, I've not heard of it.
Brain Dead is great. Look it up. I don't know if you can get it on whatever demand. It's great, but you got to stay with it.
Okay, I'll check it out.
It's sort of a comedy, quirky science fiction thing. That's all I'll
say. That's right up my alley.
It's great. Joy and I, when we watch it and we see the end credits pop up, we literally go, oh
yeah,
because we don't.
It's over. Yeah.
We watched we watched Grimm.
Okay.
I mean, I have a friend also who writes on it, but I would watch it anyway.
Yeah, that's a fun show.
It's a fun show. Yeah. It's silly. I'm not going to tell you some of the other shows I watch because they're really dumb, and it's like, oh, no, I got to finish this show.
No, are you the kind of person that once you start watching a show, you're in?
Well, if I'm in deep enough.
Yeah.
I mean, if it's going to go for 3 seasons, no, I'll stop.
Yeah.
I stopped watching American Horror Story. I thought that was a little too much for me.
Yeah.
I stopped watching... Well, I stopped watching Breaking Bad. It's brilliant. And Bryan Cranston's a friend of mine.
Yeah.
And he's brilliant.
He's great.
And so is Aaron
Paul.
Aaron Paul.
Yeah.
They're great. And like I said, same thing with The Wire and Arrested Development.
Yeah.
If somebody said to me, if my children said,
do it again, go back.
Go back and try it, maybe we'd try it. Because people are saying it's the greatest thing on television. I just can't. I can't get into it.
There are some shows that I have been on for like 10 seasons and watch them from the beginning, and I don't even like it anymore, but I feel this weird sense of obligation. I'm like, well, I don't want to betray them. I've been here the whole time.
But comfort is a good, it's a good concept.
I mean,
you kind of watch it after a busy day or a crap day. You say,
someone.
Well, I think that's, and I'm using I Love Lucy as an example, which was brilliant, but it's like you get to know and love these people, and at the end of the day, you turn it on because you know Lucy.
Yeah.
And that's at least the way I figured, that's the secret of series.
Yeah.
You get people hooked, and even if it's not great or even good, you're comfortable with these people in your house every night.
Yeah. It's like, I look at it like those middle-of-the-road kind of restaurants, like your Bennigan's, your TGI Fridays kind of things. They're like, it's not great. It's not bad. We know what
we're
getting.
But you won't walk away hungry.
Yeah. We see them anywhere all over the country. And I know what I'm going to get in there. Let's go in and we'll get some pizza shooters or whatever they serve, those kind of things. Well, thank you so much for doing this. It's been great talking
to you. It's great. It's great meeting you too.
Thank you.
There's another person in the room.
There is. My wife is here, everybody. She's been doing sign language interpretation, so hopefully you all saw that.
It was great, man. It was really great.
Thank you. I didn't lie to you, Stuart. Fantastic. What a great guy. Love talking to him, and I think that you loved hearing me talk to him. I know that's very presumptuous of me, but I think that I have empirical evidence to prove that you will enjoy that. So again, thanks to Stuart for sitting down and talking to me. Love talking to him, and I love talking to you guys, so make sure you email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or tweet at me at tvguidance or go on our Facebook page, just search TV Guidance Counselor, or if you don't want anything that's two-way interactive, you can just go on iTunes and rate and review the show. I always read those reviews, as I am slightly obsessive, but I love hearing from you guys, and we have brand new episodes each and every Wednesday of the show, so be sure to be here next week when we have another great guest on TV Guidance Counselor.
I've been holding my own.